on this beautiful morning, in this beautiful place, for this wonderful occasion, and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, it is my great honor and privilege to welcome you, graduates, family and friends, faculty and staff, Board of Trustee members and administration, and Dr. Gavin Ortland, to this, the 15th commencement ceremony of Providence Christian College. What a joy and blessing it is to come together to do this. We desire that ultimately God is honored in what we do this morning, but he is honored as his people, you graduates, are acknowledged for your achievements, and when you express gratitude to family, faculty, and all who have helped you get to this point. Let's get on with that, shall we? And while we do this, remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this beautiful day, and thank you for calling us together for this celebration, Lord, as we celebrate your grace and mercy to us through Christ, and as we celebrate with these young men and women as they graduate. Lord, thank you for your hand of blessing on Providence Christian College these years. Continue to hold us faithful. May all that we do here honor you in the classroom, athletic fields, and courts, and beyond. Be blessed by what we do here, Lord. And may your hand of blessing also be on these graduates, Lord. Thank you for the families that they come from. Thank you for calling them to Providence, for blessing their time here. Be with them now as they wrap up. Watch over them, lead them, guide them to good jobs, to good schools, to service in church and community. Lord, may all they do from this point on further your kingdom and bring you glory. Be with us now as we celebrate and acknowledge their achievement here. Lord, be honored in this program this morning. And again, may you receive all the glory through all that we do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand and join us in song.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song. Buenos días. Hello, everyone. Thank you to the province and leadership for inviting me to pray this morning. It is an honor to do so, especially because my daughter Melanie is among the students graduating this weekend, and I could not be more proud of her. My name is Alejandro Evangelista, and I'm not only Melanie's dad, but also a pastor at New Hope Church in a little town called Shafter here in California. My family and I love Providence University, what it stands for, the values that it upholds, and how it continually seeks to glorify the Lord through equipping the next generation. I hope that my prayer this morning can be of encouragement to the graduates, their families, and the faculty staff alike. We are here this morning to worship and thank our God and Savior Jesus for this year's graduation. I invite you to pray with me. Our Father, what a great privilege we have this morning to be able to come and thank you, recognizing that you are the only source of all wisdom and intelligence. If we move, we get up, and can have clear understanding of things, it is because of your divine grace and mercy you allow us all of this. We recognize that everything we are, learn, and know, we are only to you, since your knowledge and wisdom surpasses all human understanding. As we take this morning to look back at the journey that has been for all these students, we thank you for every difficult moment that all these graduates experienced all these years. Whatever has been time or illness, anxiety, sadness, frustration, or even being nervous before exam. And why do we thank you for all the difficulties that this student had to experience during their college years? Because we know that it's through all those difficult situations that you made them mature, developed their passions, and grew their faith. Because they learned to be independent from their parents, but at the same time, they learned to depend on you as the only hope and support for their needs. I pray that there cannot be an attitude or complaint and regret for all these hardships, but rather to recognize that you were always with them. Our eyes, our sight is on you, O Father. It is also our prayer that all these graduates can remember the pleasant and joyful moments that they experienced on this educational institution. May all those pleasant experiences also flood their minds and fill their hearts with joy, that the good memories can be greater than those negative experiences that could live here, that they can remember all those pleasant moments of pure friendship with their classmate. Father, we ask you that you please also allow these graduates to recognize all the time and teachers, all the teaching that their professors were able to sow in their minds and heart, that all these students can value and appreciate the fact that they had the opportunity to study in a college that not only excellent at academic level, but also one that prioritizes the spiritual value of wisdom that can only come from you, O Lord. That the experience of having been in a Christian school like Providence may have left a positive mark in their life where they can remember the rest of their life and they can share this testimony of what you only can do with other people. Our Father, we also take this opportunity to thank you very much for the time you give those students here in Providence, for the teachers who daily give their best to them. Lord, we also want to thank you for all those who have contributed one way or another to make this day one of celebration and rejoicing by achieving one more step on this road of success for your glory. We thank you, Lord, for the teachers, the administrative staff, the board of directors, that you have placed in this university, for the continued support and prayers of the parents and family members of these students. Our Father, we present to you this group of students, graduates, and we ask you, Father, that as they begin the new stage in their life, you can bless them with wisdom so that in everything they can be guided by you, whatever is their professional life, work, or families, that they may bear witness to your power, your glory, and love for a world that desperately needs a true hope. We also ask that you continue to bless this university, the staff, and especially the teaching staff, so that they can continue instructing the new generation with the knowledge, academic, and wisdom that can only be found on you and your work. We pray for the future plans of the school, that those plans may be honored to you, Father, and that this university can continue to be a light in the midst of darkness, that it can continue to teach the absolute truth of your word during these difficult times of confusion. To you belong the power, the glory, the honor forever. Amen.
Please stand for the responsive reading. Our reading today is from Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth.
My soul makes a boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad.
Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Those who look at him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Please be seated.
If a young college graduate were to ask you what they could do to be successful in their life after graduation, I am sure there are many people who could produce a list of things that they would believe would lead to a successful life. One may say, for example, that many things in life are a sort of exchange. You work hard in college, you get scholarships, a degree, and hopefully a future job. You work hard at a job, you get promoted, you get a raise, and you're successful. What you put into things is what you get out of them. You get what you deserve. This seems fair and just. How would the professors and staff at Providence Christian College answer the question of what would lead to a successful life after graduation? Providence Christian College is a Christian college. What does this mean? At the heart of Christianity is a truth that seems counterintuitive to everything we are usually taught. R.C. Sproul said that, "Perhaps the most difficult task for us to perform is to rely on God's grace and God's grace alone for our celebration. It is difficult for our pride to rest on grace, Grace is for other people, for beggars. We don't want to live by a heavenly welfare system. We want to earn our own way and atone for our own sins. We like to think that we will get to go to heaven because we deserve to be there. Yet this is not how the kingdom of God works. Instead, we do nothing and we receive eternal, abundant life. We do nothing and we receive all the spiritual blessings in the heavenly places, the gifts of peace, joy, and hope. We do nothing and we receive reconciliation with God. We do nothing but receive a gift won by the sacrifice of another, a gift that could never be earned, deserved, or added to. Providence Christian College upholds biblical truth in a culture where denying or undermining the inerrancy of Scripture is more profitable, where the open preaching of the gospel is becoming increasingly rare, and when keeping Christ at the center is an ideal that often takes second place to strategies deemed more effective in the rest of the world's eyes. After reflecting upon all of this, to answer the original question of what would lead to a successful life after graduation at Providence, my guess is that the professors and staff who dedicate their lives to working for this school would answer that one always needs to remember and live by the following truth. We, those of us who have put our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, are saved by grace alone. Through faith alone, in Christ alone, as revealed in Scripture alone, to the glory of God alone. This truth is not meant to be concealed, nor once grasped are they able to be easily forgotten. Ever increasing in knowledge of God and His Word is a lifelong endeavor. Ever sharing with others those truths one learns is a lifelong vocation. Ever learning how that biblical truth applies to every other aspect of life is a part of our lifelong redemption as new creations in Christ. As a graduating class, my hope is that we would be able to share the truth that has been shared with us. It feels insufficient to simply say thank you. Thank you to all the people who sacrificed so much that would be incomprehensible in the world's eyes to sacrifice, in order to teach me and every student here truth that is eternally worthwhile and meaningful. The truth of God's word, the truth of the gospel, the truth of the surpassing worth of Christ, the truth of God's amazing grace, the truth of the beauty of a life lived for the glory of God. And yet, personally, as someone who feels like I have been gifted so much, can only say what someone who has received a great undeserved gift can say. Thank you.
Thank you. Our scripture reading for today is from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hardworking farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Christ, Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself.
I have the distinct honor today of introducing our speaker for this commencement ceremony. Gavin Ortlund is a pastor, author, speaker, and apologist for the Christian faith. He serves as the senior pastor of First Baptist Church of Ojai in Ojai, California. Gavin has a PhD from Fuller Theological Seminary in Historical Theology and a Master's in Divinity from Covenant Theological Seminary. He's the author of 8 books, as well as numerous academic and popular articles. He runs the YouTube channel, Truth Unites, which seeks to provide an authentic voice on theology, apologetics, and the Christian life. Truth Unites has a dual purpose, as both a theological resource to the church, as well as an apologetics voice to our culture. In its inward-facing role, it seeks to serve the church with theological education. It especially focuses on historical retrieval and theological triage, seeking to buttress and unify evangelical theology amidst its current fragmentation. It also produces content in defense of Protestantism. In its outward-facing role, Truth Unites seeks to provide a winsome and credible voice to the culture for the existence of God and the resurrection of Christ. He is a husband to Esther and a father to Isaiah, Naomi, Elijah, Miriam, and Abigail. Please join me in welcoming our 2023 commencement speaker, Dr. Gavin Ortlund.
That introduction was so kind and makes me seem a lot more intense than I really am. I feel so honored to be here today among esteemed faculty, board members, staff and administration, family, friends, other loved ones, and most of all, the graduating class of 2023. Congratulations to you all. I hope that you feel joy today as you reach this amazing milestone. This is a big deal, what you've accomplished. And one of the wonderful things about being a Christian is that all joy and all accomplishment in this life is just a foretaste of heaven. Because heaven will be that ultimate feeling of completion and resting from labor and accomplishment. It was happy to watch you all walk down the aisle and hear the eruptions of applause and celebration and think that's a little bit of what it will feel like. Those of us who follow Christ and suffer with Christ in this world, what we have in store for us. But today is not just a day of completion, it's also a day of expectation. Looking out ahead, some of you have new jobs. Some of you are looking for a new job, perhaps. Some of you will be going to grad school, maybe moving, making new friends. You're completing your time at Providence and opening a new chapter, kind of looking out on the rest of your life. So I want to pose a very simple question that really dovetails with the wonderful comments from Hannah just a few moments ago. As you look out to the rest of your life, What is a good life? How do we live well? The other week, I came across a YouTube video of celebrities sharing about how fame doesn't bring happiness. And it was at points it was sort of funny and they were telling jokes, but there was this deep heaviness underneath it all. And some of the comments were not funny. It was very poignant to hear people be honest about how when you get to the top, you know, what so many of them were saying is it was when I made it to the top that I felt the most empty inside. One of them said, the bigger my TV show got, the bigger my depression got too. Another was talking about how strange it was for people to recognize him at the airport and all the money that he was making. And he said these words, I'm doing everything I dreamt of doing for 30 years. It all came true. And I'm the least happy I've ever been. I'm the closest to not wanting to be alive that I've ever been, and I have every single thing on paper that I have ever wanted. I really admired and appreciated his honesty, and I have to say that I can relate to that. It's the times in my life when I've accomplished the most that terrible question, usually not right away, usually a few days later, that terrible question comes in. Maybe some of you know what I'm talking about. The question comes in, is that it? That didn't bring the sense of completion and lasting happiness that I expected it would. I wonder if any of you can relate to that. Maybe an experience that you've been striving for, making the first string team or getting the job that you want or something like that. And it comes, but it doesn't bring that sense of completion that you're looking for. Maybe others of us are, especially a day like today, on the other side of that, we're looking out ahead toward those dreams and we're thinking, this is what I'd like to accomplish in my life. This is what I want to achieve. I want to get that many followers on Instagram, or I want to buy that house, or I want to get into that grad school, or whatever it may be. And those dreams may be in themselves okay, but they're not the ultimate. One last quote from that YouTube video. This is the most poignant one. This is actually a follow-up video. Famous actor who said, I wish everybody could become rich and famous just so they would see that it's not the answer. Well, that raises the question, what is the answer? As we look out upon our lives, how should we aspire to live? What does it mean to live well in this world? Well, the Bible has an answer to that. Lots of people in our culture think of the Bible as kind of a narrow and constricting book, but the Bible has so much to say about the enjoyment of life, flourishing and blessing. In fact, the Bible tells us how to flourish and how to live a blessed life. Here's how King David puts it. We read these verses earlier. Psalm 34, starting at verse 11, he says, come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous and his ears toward their cry. In this psalm, David is celebrating God's salvation. But in these verses, he pauses from praising God for a few moments and gives fatherly instruction. That's why it begins with these words, come, O children, listen to me. It's like a grandfather pulling his grandchildren aside and saying, let me tell you what I've learned throughout my life. And essentially, David is making the appeal of how to live a good life. You see that in these words, who of you loves life and desires to see many good days? It's as though David is saying, who out there wants to live well? Who wants to have a blessed and long and happy life? Let me tell you how to do that. Now just observe very quickly, and I hope these will strike your heart as they've struck mine as an encouragement and a help in our lives. Two of his answers. The first one is do good, and the second is trust the Lord. First, do good. It's interesting that David's first answer to this question of what is a good life has to do with our speech. Verse 13, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. This has become more and more precious to me as a father of five young children, looking out at the culture that we are facing, wondering what it will be like for them to grow up. It's harder than ever to have godliness in our speech because the norm in our culture is increasingly through to ungodly speech. Social media has completely changed the game. The norm increasingly is toward bragging, overly combative and hateful speech to people you disagree with, sarcasm and snark, dishonesty, slander, misinformation. Unfortunately, there's a strong pull towards those things. That will be the natural drift in our world right now. And that's why David, I think, uses these words, these verbs in the next verse. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Godly speech and godly character must be sought. We must resolve, say, Lord, I will be a man or a woman of godly speech. I will use words that are kind and that are upbuilding. The power of our speech is amazing upon others, including what we type on social media accounts. David is saying to live a happy life, to live a blessed life, is to keep a close guard over your lips, to use your words to build up, to bless, not to tear down and to curse. Second, David says a happy life is a life of trusting in the Lord. Verse 15, the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous and his ears toward their cry. All throughout this psalm, David is just celebrating the salvation of God. God answers prayer. God hears our prayers. He delivers his people. He sees his people. David is saying this because of one particular experience he has had in being delivered from one of his enemies, a man named Abimelech. But the whole psalm is celebrating the character of God. God is a God who delights to save his people, and he is worthy of our trust. David is saying, think of the grandfather coaching his grandchildren, let me tell you how God has come through for me. He's worth it. You can trust him with your whole life. He's a God who hears our prayers. And this godly speech and godly character we pursue is not done in order to earn God's salvation, but as a grateful response to it. My simple comment from all of that to those of you who are graduating and for all of us is this. We never need to fear that we are missing out when we trust in the Lord. If you surrender your whole life to the Lord and follow him with all of your heart in every area of your life, you do not need to fear you will miss out. The best life, the happiest life, is a life of walking with the Lord. Now, this is the opposite of how we are tempted to think. We think of those celebrities I mentioned at the very beginning. So many of us will assume it's those things that will result in a happy and blessed life. A little boy was once asked, what is God like? And he said, oh, he's the kind of person going around making sure no one is having any fun. And unfortunately, he's not the only one who thinks like that. In this psalm, God is saying, no, I desire your flourishing. As a father of five young children, I found that this is helpful when I am parenting very often. So I have our eldest is 10, our youngest will turn 1 this summer. The Ortland home is very high energy. And I have so much fun. I love them so much. Every parent understands this. I feel as though I love them more than I love my own life. Every parent knows that feeling. You desire for your children's happiness first, even more than your own. Oftentimes when I'm giving them instruction or direction about something where I anticipate that it's not what they will want to hear, I have found it helpful to say these words to them so they know where it's coming from. Isaiah or Elijah or whoever it is I'm speaking to, I want you to flourish. I want you to succeed. I love you so much. And therefore, this is what I'm asking you to do. In Psalm 34, God is saying, I want you to flourish. I want you to know a blessed life. So turn from evil and do good, and trust in the Lord with all of your heart. To finish, I just want to acknowledge the difficulty of this. Some of us may be sitting here today facing challenges, suffering that no one else in this room knows about, fears and anxieties about your future. Life is hard. With anticipation and expectation and looking ahead, there come great fears. Some of us might say, you know, that's great that David saw God's salvation in his life like that, but I haven't seen that, and I'm not sure if I really believe that God is trustworthy in that way. I'm not sure that I'm really convinced that it is the best life to walk with the Lord. And I just want to remind us of the central core of our faith and how we can have confidence in what God is saying to us through Psalm 34, and that is Jesus. Jesus came into our world before we had taken a single step to God. And he died upon the cross and rose from the dead for us to make us the very children of God. Whatever love I feel for my kids is nothing compared to the love that our Heavenly Father has for each of us, for each of you graduating today. If God has done that for us in the person and work of Jesus Christ, we can trust him that the best way to live is fully surrendered to him. So graduates and all of us, I exhort you to heed the words of this psalm as you look out upon your life. Trust in the Lord and do good, and you will be very blessed. God bless you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for gathering us today. Thank you for the joy of this event and the way it gives us a little foretaste of how wonderful it will be on that day when we reach the ultimate destination and accomplishment of having completed our life in this world and standing face to face before you, our Creator, giving an account of our lives. And Lord, we thank you for Jesus, who's made a way for us so that we can approach you as a father and a friend, one to whom we've been fully reconciled. I pray for each person in this room that you would touch their heart through your Holy Spirit today, minister to them, draw them to yourself, give them your peace and your love and a sense of your nearness, and especially for our graduates, I pray for your deep blessing upon their lives, and I pray that they would taste and see that the Lord is good in walking with you throughout their lives, that they would discover this is the answer. What doesn't come through wealth and fame comes through knowing and walking with you. In the name of Christ we pray, amen.
Will the degree candidates for the class of 2023 please rise? Sorry.
Dr. Alexander, I now present to you the Chief Academic Officer of the college, the 15th graduating class of Providence Christian College. They have fulfilled the requirements for their respective programs, and therefore, upon the recommendation of the faculty, I present them to you for the conferral of the degree Bachelor of Arts.
Members of the class of 2023, by virtue of the authority entrusted to me by the state of California and of the responsibilities invested in me by the Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the 15th graduating class of Providence Christian College the degree Bachelor of Arts. Now I invite the graduates to stand and take position on the staircase to my right.
those students receiving the degree Bachelor of Arts are Lee George Atkinson, Jr. Jose Andres Campos Amaya. Anthony Alfredo Castro. Nicholas Chavez. Mindy Vianney Cortez. Aiden Delgado. Mark Eaton. Melanie Alejandra Evangelista. Hannah Elizabeth Fenton. Trenton Friesen. Anaya Sine Dainese. Harris. Madison May Hernandez. Mark Lucas Lingtat. Edward Anthony Lopez. Isaiah Omar Lopez. Andrew J. Macias. Samuel Justin Meadows. Matthew Miranda. Ricky Navarro. Savannah Ray Page. Kiera Paul. Caitlin Margaret Robinson. Jesus Sebastian Rodarte. Caitlin Marie Sanchez. Cassidy Marie Sanchez. Sophia Aralee Serrano. Tyler Justin Stauffer. Lauren Taylor. And Raquel Noemi Valdovinos.
Please stand and sing with us.
Like so.
Please be seated. I would ask that parents and guests remain seated at this time. Please wait for the reception of graduates and faculty before you exit out the back. Immediately following this ceremony, everyone is invited to a reception for the graduates in the adjacent parlor classrooms to my left. If you'd like a picture with your graduate, proceed outside to Los Robles Avenue, directly behind you, where our photographer, my wife, will be waiting. Class of 2023 and faculty, please rise. Graduates, it is now fitting and proper for you to take your tassel and move it to the left side of your cap. Family, friends, faculty, board, and staff, I now present to you the graduating class of 2023.
Graduates, you may be seated. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I congratulate you, graduates, once again, on your personal and your academic achievements that we have come to celebrate this morning. You all deserve to be commended for your persistence, your desire, your creativity, and your focus, which have propelled you to this climactic moment. But it's altogether fitting that we conclude this ceremony by acknowledging the source of all life, the source of all ability, and the source of all achievements, and that is our creating and our redeeming God. It's our prayer as a board that in the coming years, you will credit every victory to the providential care of your sovereign God, and that you will dedicate every effort to the praise of his great and holy name before a watching world. And so would all of you join me in prayer as we acknowledge our Creator and then receive a parting blessing from his word. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, your comfort and peace, and that you have given these graduates all they need for godliness and life through the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We ask that the riches of your grace and peace might be multiplied in their lives with every passing day as they come to a deeper knowledge of you through your holy word. May they desire to live godly lives in Christ Jesus, to grow in grace, and in all their vocational labors to produce spiritual fruit that is honoring to you. Help them to be diligent and disciplined in their Christian callings in the world, not relying on their own abilities and excellence, but trusting in you and working through the power of the Holy Spirit. And may their lives always remain hidden with Christ in God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now this final benediction from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 through 8. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.